where you are. Do not break the stillness of this moment. For this is a time of mystery. A time when imagination is free and moves forward swiftly, silently. This is the Haunting Hour. Assignment Death. I'm Dick Ryan. Maybe you've read some of my stories in a certain National Picture magazine. Well, here's a scoop that never got in. One editor and two vice presidents fainted at the thought. Like I told my boss, horror doesn't always come wrapped up in a haunted house with the wind howling outside. Sometimes it walks along behind you, breathes down your neck, and whispers something about a slug of lead in your back. And the few gray hairs that staff photographer Ellen Maitland and I got out of it didn't come from lack of vitamins. It was late afternoon when Ellen and another photographer, Larry Nelson, came into my office. I remember that I was busy at the time.
Dick, will you please stop typing and listen to me?
Another time, Ellen. I've got to get this story out.
Dick, you've got to help me get a picture of Mike Velvetto, the gangster.
Are you crazy? Is she kidding me, Larry?
Well, it's this way, Dick. Boss wants to feature the story and what's happened to all the old public enemies. He's got photos of every last one of them except Velvet.
Can't you see what a feather would be in my cap, Dick?
There isn't a newspaper morgue in town has anything on him.
Of course not, Larry. Pictures of Velvet don't land in the morgue. It's the people who take them. This baby is no retired gangster.
Hey, Ellen, told you Dick was a friend of his.
No, not exactly. I dug up some stuff in one of his rackets and handed it over to the DA's office.
But Larry said Mike Velvetto likes you. How come?
Well, he wriggled out of the charges easy enough. He thought it was a big joke and told everybody he admired my spirit.
And he called Dick to his headquarters and offered him a job as one of his boys.
That's the funniest thing I ever heard. What a strange man.
You can't help liking Velvet. That's the danger. But he's poisoned just the same.
Well, Dick, I'm going to get his picture whether you help me or not.
Well, if that's the way you feel, Ellen, I guess I'll have to go along. You'll do it my way?
Of course. Oh, I knew you'd help me, Dick. You're wonderful.
Wait and see. If we leave now, we'll be there just after dark. Get the camera, Ellen, and don't bring something too conspicuous.
I won't. We'll go just as soon as I come back, huh?
I'm coming along, Dick. Do you think this is dangerous?
There's one way it might be done, Larry. You'll have to help me with my plan. It'll be dangerous enough if we succeed. If we fail, it'll be just plain murder. Button your coats, boys and girls. This is it.
This old Goliath? Mike Velvetto can't be very successful.
You're going to get the surprise of your life in through this door. Straight ahead.
I don't like the way those mechanics look at us, Dick.
No mind, pal. It's the camera Ellen's carrying that's got him stumped. You know, Velvet lives in the penthouse on top of this building, but he has his office back there.
Would you look at that character lounging by the door?
Well, oh, well, have I seen that tight-fitting coat, that pulled-down hat?
That is Rosie. If you think that bulge in his pocket is a harmonica, think again.
I don't like this place.
You just take your picture and keep your temper, baby. Hi, Rosie. Velvet in? It's all right, kid. Relax.
Thanks, loudmouth. I'm the nervous type. Better camera?
Guess it's the first time, Rosie. Tell Velvet Dick Ryan's here with a couple of friends.
Why not? Tell her damn them things smash easy.
He warned Velvet by pushing that buzzer. The door opens electrically.
I don't think I like Rosie.
I don't think Rosie likes you. Keep sick, Ellen. Be polite and keep your temper.
You two must think I'm redheaded. I'm sorry. That's the second time.
The chief says okay. Let the dame come first.
Go ahead, Ellen. I think Rosie wants to frisk us. We're clean as a whistle.
Please, Rosie. Those are my friends.
I'm sorry, kid. You can frisk us some other time. Hello there, Velvet.
Delighted to see you again, Dick, my friend.
I'd like you to meet a couple of colleagues, Ellen Maitland and Larry Nelson.
How do you do?
We were going by. We thought we'd drop in.
But of course. Perhaps a little drink of something?
No, thanks.
No? I see you like my office, Miss Maitland.
Why, I'm pleased with Mr. Velvetto. It's beautiful. I never dreamed.
That's such a rough exterior. I know. Deception is my business.
Oh, but these pictures. They're the real thing, not reproductions. Look, Larry.
Yes, I noticed the minute I came in. Mr. Valvetta must be something of a collector.
In a modest way. Oh, I see you've noticed that daub in back of my desk, Mr. Nelson. Hideous, isn't it? A fine example of non-objective art.
Well, personally, I don't go for lines, planes, colors all thrown together without any meaning.
But that picture has a special meaning for my associates. You see, Mr. Nelson, it fronts a wall safe, which very often contains large sums of money. That they appreciate. But I talk of myself while Miss Maitland is anxious to take my picture.
Oh!
Well, you guessed it, Velvet. I know how you feel, but she insisted. And then your reputation for never refusing a beautiful woman.
Oh, well, you know me, Dick. Well, I shall sit here behind my desk and look like a successful merchant. Please, Rosie. We should have explained to him that Miss Maitland was reaching in her pocket for a flashbulb.
Though I had forgotten that Rosie was still with us.
That is one of his virtues. So unobtrusive.
The nervous type is always dangerous, though, don't you think, Velvet? I'll just sit here out of the way until Ellen's set.
I see our charming friend is ready. Well, I shall continue to talk so that we shall have a more informal study.
Okay.
Well, over so soon?
I'm sorry if the flashbulb blinded you. One shot Ellen, they call me.
A lovely camera. May I see it?
When you see Mr. Galvetto,
him, sister.
Don't be afraid, Ellen. Velvet hates violence.
You're afraid I'll smash your camera?
What?
No, nothing of the sort. I'm curious to see if it came out well. We'll open the bag.
Oh, so. Please. Oh, now you've ruined the negative.
Oh, you mean the light. Oh, I'm dreadfully sorry, Miss Maitland. I simply don't have any understanding of these things. If I've spoiled it, I must pay you.
But you did it on purpose. You let me take it and then...
Temper, baby.
I don't blame her in the least. Here, Miss Maitland, I must pay. I insist.
Oh, no, thank you.
You might as well take it, Ellen. You'll hurt his feelings. Well, we'll be running along. Nice to see you, Velvet.
Goodbye.
I'll see you, Marcy.
No hard feelings, I hope. You must drop in again. I'll not be so clumsy next time you take my picture, Miss Maitland.
Yes, I bet he won't. Well, thank you, Rosie. Give my love to the wife and kids.
Velvet's soft, Ryan. I ain't. Keep your nose clean, loudmouth.
Excellent advice, Rosie. You needn't see us to the street. Come on, Ellen.
I'm looking forward to that street, don't mind saying. How about you, Ellen?
I'm furious with the both of you. I'll never speak to either of you again, letting me make a fool of myself like that.
What, Ellen? You didn't actually think he'd let you shoot him without a squawk.
Now hold that until we get out. Okay, ladies before gents. Could you get it, Larry?
And it passed out when Rosie started to frisk you. She found that candid camera under my coat.
You mean you had a midget concealed? Of course, Ellen.
Of course. How else? I watched you, synchronized it with your flash. You held his attention. I got the picture.
Well, just because you came back to the office doesn't mean you have to work, Dick Ryan.
Now, there's nothing we can do until Larry gets that developed and tries an enlargement.
He's had enough time. If you'd come back here with us...
Now, look, Ellen, his apartment darkroom is the safest place for that negative. This has got to be a secret for a while, remember?
Well, that's all right with me. And I'm still mad, Dick. Why in the world didn't you tell me?
Because it wouldn't have been as convincing. No act in the world could have had that ring of sincerity, Ellen. Wow, talk about registering disappointment and rage.
Let's change the subject. What if you didn't fool him?
Then the three of us had better pack our... Oh, good. There must be Larry now. Hello.
Hi, Dick. Tell Ellen she's got a picture. Couldn't have been better.
Good and clear? What about enlarging?
Every detail. That's what I wanted. I'm going back in my dark room now and really blow it up. If you'll want to come out...
What's the matter?
I thought I heard someone come in.
Larry.
What?
Larry, all right?
Is
there
something wrong?
Yeah. Come on, we've got to get to Larry quick. Oh. It's backfired, Ellen. We didn't fool anybody but ourselves.
Look, Ryan, I'm only a copper, not a mind reader. If Elvis behind this, like you say... You've seen the last of your friend.
There's no question who did it, Lieutenant, but if Larry's still alive, we've got to get to him.
If he was alive when he went out of here, he ain't now. I know that mob. We'll probably find him at the bottom of the river in a few days.
You got here before we did. Wasn't there
you
any...
You saw everything we did. One bloody print on the floor near the phone.
From what you say, this gorilla probably sliced him with his gun butt and then went after that picture.
And Larry came too, and you suppose they took him to question him?
Why not? You say the three of you were in on it. Only it was a revolver shot that made the neighbors call us. Sounds like curtains to me.
I didn't hear any shot over the phone.
Because that punk pulled the wires out. Here comes your young lady.
Dick, it's awful. It looks as though a cyclone hit Larry's back room.
Yeah, I know. Rosie sure messed it up. No sign of the picture, of course.
No. Dick, if you don't mind, I'd rather not stay here any longer.
Yeah, I know how you feel. Let's go. Thanks for letting us look around, Lieutenant. Mm-hmm. We'll be at the office tomorrow if you want it.
Well, if I got your story straight, it might be smart for you and the young lady to kind of keep out of sight for a while.
Yes, you can depend on that. I know how Rosie works.
We'll pull him in. Give him a going over. Of course, your story isn't exactly proof, but it might give Velvet ideas.
Such as shutting us up.
Oh.
Well, pleasant dreams, Lieutenant.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, Ellen.
Oh, Dick, I feel sick. About Larry, I mean.
Yeah, me too. Let's walk down. It's only one flight.
All right.
You know, they could have carried Larry down the fire escape and back.
Dick, do you really think he's still alive?
I wish to heaven I... Oh, for Pete's sake, why kid myself? No, I don't.
And you think we're in terrible danger, don't you?
Now, don't let the lieutenant scare you, baby. If Velvet's got the negative back now, I don't...
But we were in on it just as much as Larry.
That doesn't seem fair. He should take the rap, does it?
Certainly doesn't.
Well, let's grab a cab. I'll take you home. There's one right there at the corner. Back into the hall, Ellen, quick. Press back against the wall. It was that cab. The shot came from that cab.
Dick, what can you do?
We're all right now, Ellen. We're all right now.
We're being hunted, Dick. Velvet's after us. What about tomorrow?
Just keep your fingers crossed and pray the guy was wrong who said tomorrow never comes.
Hello, this is Marvin Miller with another page from your American Heritage scrapbook. Sell the cook stove if necessary and come to Chicago. You must see this fair. A pretty compelling message, isn't it? Well, that's what one of the 27 million visitors to Chicago's Columbian Exposition of 1893 wrote to his parents. The exposition was described as a dream in plaster. The dream was born in 1891 when 15 of America's foremost architects, sculptors, painters, and landscape planners met in Chicago to design a world's exposition commemorating the 400th anniversary of Columbus's discovery of a new world. It took a near miracle to transform the 650 acres of lakefront property into landscape parks and islands, with lagoons to mirror the 14 white plaster exposition palaces. But it was done. The World's Columbian Exposition was dedicated on October 12, 1892, but construction delays kept the general public away until May 1, 1893. President Grover Cleveland was there for the official opening. For 6 months, 150,000 visitors a day were treated to the marvels of the fair. They came from all over the world to see the many wonders, such as a 12-foot statue made of pure silver from the mining state of Montana, California's exhibit of a mounted knight in full armor made entirely of prunes, the pillar of light in the Palace of Electricity, which gave many their first view of Thomas Edison's incandescent miracle, a 264-foot wheel designed by George Washington Gale Ferris, from which 60 persons riding in the wheel's 36 big cars could look down on the exposition's midway and see the exhibits of the 77 countries represented, the minarets of Persia, the camels of Egypt, the pagodas of Japan. This was the Columbian Exposition, a miniature world built on the shores of Lake Michigan.
Dick Ryan back again. Sadder and wiser, and no wonder. I'd helped Ellen Maitland get her picture of Mike Velvetto, the gangster, all right. We let Ellen go through the motions while Larry Nelson actually did the job with a candid camera hidden under his coat. He called us later from his apartment to tell us it was a perfect shot, and a moment later I heard the fear in his voice as Rosie slugged him. One look at his wrecked darkroom and the spot of blood near his telephone, and we didn't need the police to tell us the negative was gone and Larry would probably be found in the river the next day. And it didn't take pot shots from a passing taxi to let us know Ellen and I were next on Velvet's list. You have to live the nightmare of being on the wrong end of a manhunt to feel the horror of it. You don't feel like going home to bed. You get a craving for lights, bright lights, and for people. Lots of people. That's why Ellen and I picked a well-lighted eating joint for a snack before I took her home.
Let's sit at the counter, Dick, near the door.
Okay. Now, let's take a peek at the menu.
Oh.
What's the matter with you, Ellen?
Look in that mirror. The reflection of that man back there. Dick, he's one of those men from Velvet's garage.
Well, you're crazy, Ellen. He didn't follow.
Well, let's get out of here, Dick. I'm scared.
All right. Straight for the door and don't look back.
I don't have to. He got up when we did.
Never mind that. We'll lose him in the crowd. Come on.
Don't walk so fast, Dick. I can't keep up with you.
We may have imagined that man was following us, Ellen. At the same time, I don't like getting out of the crowd.
We turn left here, Dick.
Oh, you would live on one of these quiet side streets, way down the end, I suppose.
That's right. The end house on the other side of the street.
All right, come on, let's cross. The light's with us.
Look out, Dick. There's a car coming right through that red light.
Don't stop, Ellen. Keep going. Come on, run.
How do you like? He missed us by 2 feet.
Crazy drunken driver.
Drunk nothing. That car was parked at the intersection waiting for you to come home. Our pal Velvet sure means business.
Dick, I don't want to go home. I won't. Velvet knows where I live. The car waiting to run us over proves it. Maybe somebody's waiting in my apartment in the dark.
You've got to snap out of this, Ellen.
Well, let's try to get back to the office. We'll sit up the rest of the night. Please, Dick. I'll feel better when it's daylight.
That's what I thought, but daylight didn't help. In fact, we felt even more out in the open. That's the terror of being hunted. It grows like some clinging, choking weed. We set out for breakfast, and neither of us left the editorial offices until I ducked out for a shave about noon. But when the barber lifted the razor and I got the shakes, I knew that that was the breaking point.
I'm so glad you came back, Dick. I don't think I can stand this any longer. I jump when anyone speaks. I watch strangers.
You don't have to tell me, Ellen. I know. I decided to have it out with Velvet. I'd rather look down Rosie's automatic than sit around waiting for it.
What are we going to do?
I'm going to Velvet, lay my cards on the table, and try to talk him out of it.
Well, I'm going with you, and don't you try to stop me.
As far as the drugstore across from his place, Ellen. You wait there, keep in the open with people around you. If I don't show up in half an hour, then the police will really have something to work on.
But, my dear Dick, I already know your whole story. The police paid me a little visit this morning. In fact, Rosie here was just released.
And who sang to the coppers, Chief? This loudmouth. Give me 10 minutes with him, Velvet.
Now, Rosie, Mr. Ryan is a friend of mine, aren't you, Dick?
Now, look, Velvet, I was a fool to trick you, a slobbering idiot, I admit it. But I came here of my own free will.
Please, not so excited, my friend. I'd forgive you, except for the little matter of the police.
If Larry's still alive, Velvet, it's not too late. Maybe you can square yourself, but if you've killed...
No, Larry is still alive. You can depend on it.
Well, then, for heaven's sakes, call off your thugs and forget it ever happened.
Still, Dick, I do not like having this picture of me floating around.
What? You mean Larry got away with it? You haven't got him?
Listen, loudmouth, we ain't got nobody.
Ungrammatic, but true.
Well, that makes a difference. In that case, I'm telling you, Velvet, lay off me. Ellen Maitland is waiting for me nearby. If I'm not back, she'll buzz the cops again.
The nice young lady with the camera? Where is she?
You think I'm crazy enough to tell you?
I think you're crazy not to. But it doesn't matter. Since the police, one of my boys has been tailing you. You know.
If anything happens to that girl...
You're a bigger fool than I thought, Ryan. As my guest, you're perfectly safe. But to leave this girl outside...
I don't know why you're lying, Velvet. But don't tell me that you can't control your trigger man.
This man's a fool, Rosie. Let me have your gun. And find that stool pigeon who was here last night. You know the one I mean.
Smithy, the little junkie?
Yeah, that one. I have a job for him.
Save some of the loudmouth for me, boss.
Well, Velvet, I didn't know you went in for handling a rod.
I'll admit it is distasteful. But you're so stupid, Dick. Come, I must lock you up. A few hours thinking will do you good. Now it's my turn to play the tricks.
I I really sweated out that afternoon. Hours went by and no Ellen. For a minute, when I heard Larry had gotten away, I thought we had the upper hand. But by evening, I was fit to be tied. First, I heard the key in the lock.
You, loudmouth. Come on.
If anything's happened to Ellen, Rosie, I'll get you in Velvet if it's the last thing I do.
I'm frightened. Why should we hurt the dame?
You had a couple of good tries at it last night.
Right, boy. Come on, get in the elevator.
Elevator? You mean that...
You've seen him before. Get in. We're going down to Velvet's office behind a garage.
Is Ellen there?
You'll see. Hold out your hand.
Handcuffs. All the modern equipment, huh, kid? Self-service elevator to the private office. Handcuffs. You got a gas chamber down there?
Shut up. Hold your hand still. Maybe you're one of Velvet's favorite characters. You ain't mine.
I'm not impressed with Velvet's hospitality, Rosie. I must have been locked up there hours. What time is it?
9. All right, no tricks now.
Ellen!
Dick!
They found you? You all right?
Of course I am, Dick. But I've been worried sick about you. They told me if I didn't come with you.
Yeah, I know, honey, I know. It's one of Velvet's bright ideas.
But you're handcuffed. Dick, they hurt you.
Break it up, love birds. Nobody ain't been hurt yet. Sit down here, loudmouth. You there, sister.
Well, this sort of looks like it, Ellen. Now you see how handy it is to have a garage outside your office. I wonder if they can spare the gas to take us for a ride.
Button my lip, right, boy. I don't like that kind of talk.
Velvet had me locked up for a long time, and when you asked me to do the strangest thing, Dick, you told me...
Look, sister, this is Velvet's party. He'll do the talking.
Maybe that's him now.
Sit quiet, both of you. I get paid for opening doors.
It's okay, Chief. Hold it, Rosie. Don't move. Be a pleasure to shoot you. Step back now.
Larry, no. They didn't kill you.
Larry, I'll be glad to see you.
For heaven's sake, boy, you all right?
Sure, fine. Keep your hand away from that pocket, Rosie.
Did you just come in time, Larry? How'd you get away from them last night?
No questions now, Ellen. Look, Larry, I don't know what's up, but we got to move fast. Velvet's around somewhere. I got a feeling he was just about to move us out of here.
Sit tight, Dick. I'll take care of everything. This mug.
Larry, did you have to do that?
I've been itching to put him out cold ever since yesterday.
Well, it's done now, Larry. Take the key out of his pocket and get these cuffs off me.
Keep your shirt on, Dick. I want to take a look at that safe.
Oh, for heaven's sake, Larry, we don't have time for that.
I happen to know there's a fortune in cash in there this minute, right behind this picture.
Listen, pal, you're nuts. Now leave it on the wall.
Non-objective art, eh, Ellen? You might like to take a good look at it. You know, does the whim of Velvet to have the combination work right into the design of that thing?
Are you serious, Larry?
Wait and see, baby. I've got that combination now. I'll have it open in a second.
Oh, you're kidding, Larry. Fooling around with that safe when it's a matter of life and death. Now cut it out.
Not me, brother. Not after I went to the trouble of getting a photo of that painting to enlarge and study.
You've got the combination from that picture yesterday? But I thought...
Oh, sure. You thought we were taking a picture of Velvet.
Well, no wonder Velvet was hunting us. If he knew you had that combination, Larry.
Wise up, chump. Velvet hasn't been hunting you. He saved your lives by keeping you hidden this afternoon. I've been hunting you.
No. Oh, Larry, no. Those shots, that taxi...
You gave me a lot of trouble, Ellen. Don't edge up, Dick. You wouldn't want this gun to go off.
I'm not, Larry. I still don't believe it. You're sick. You're out of your mind. I heard you over the phone when Rosie attacked you.
Little death scene for your benefit, Dick. I knew you'd spill the story to the cops. And when I got rid of you two, Velvet would be sent to be blamed for your killing.
But we're your friends, Larry. Why would you want to kill us?
You were the only ones who knew I had the picture. You'd have figured out that I cracked his safe once the story hit the papers.
I see. You still plan to kill us and let Rosie take the rap?
Uh-huh. That's right. Now just stand where you are, where I can see you, while I'm opening the safe.
Let him, Dick. Let him open the safe.
Very kind of you, Ellen. Now, two to the left. I appreciate both of you helping me get this combination. One to the simple as can be. Best open the door and help myself. I can... Help my eyes!
It's the flashbulb I put in the safe, Dick. It's blinded him.
Don't make a move either of you. I've still got this gun. This will wear off in a minute.
Look out, Dick. There's Velvet. He's going to kill
him. Oh. Okay, Velvet. You got him. He dropped the gun.
It was getting awfully stuffy hiding in the closet. And I suppose it wasn't very sporting of me to shoot a man who was temporarily blinded.
Larry, it's all right. You just winged him in the shoulder.
My shooting's really improving. Now let's all be very calm. How do you feel, Mr. Nelson?
Not so good.
Well, we'll fix your shoulder. And as for the effect of the flashbulb...
Now, wait just a minute. What is a flashbulb doing in that safe?
I put it there, Dick. The camera, too. Velvet made me do it, but he wouldn't tell me why.
My dear Ellen, wouldn't you have believed me if I'd told you your friend Larry was trying to kill you?
How in the world did you know Larry was after it?
I knew my boys weren't, and that Rosie hadn't killed him. If he'd staged a phony death, he had to be up to something. When the police revealed he'd taken a picture in here, it meant he had my combination.
Well, that was the neatest trick of the week. I've got to thank you for saving our lives, Velvet.
All I did was have a certain stool pigeon notify Larry that you were being held in my office, that I was out of town, and that the contents of the safe were worthwhile.
You aren't going to do anything to him, are you?
My dear Ellen, do you think I'm a gangster? Larry has a picture of me. I have one of him opening my safe. Why should anyone object to a little business-like discussion?
I think the police might object to attempted murder.
That you can't prove without me, Dick, so I suggest you forget it. If Larry is willing, he can go to work for me.
Work for you, nothing. From now on, Larry is going to work for the warden.